not study like already before.
Yes, the strength of hips. They are telling that because of. Good morning, Kinshleta.
Good morning, miss.
How are you, Rio?
I'm fine, miss.
Okay. Just give me around 1 minute. Let's just wait for Harshit to join. Otherwise, after 1 minute, we are going to start the class.
Okay, fine.
Okay, then let's start the class, okay? Now, today we are going to extend our topic regarding capital rationing. As you do know, Anjalika and Atif, both of you, as you do know, that we do have some kind of projects which are divisible, which can be done in part or as a total, whatever the company's wish is. Sometimes there are some kinds of projects which are not going to be done in part. It's not possible for the management to complete the project in part. It has to be done in entirety, or the management has to decide to leave it all. So these kind of projects are known as indivisible projects. As your book says, if a project is indivisible, it must be done in its entirety or not at all. So the organizations must have to think that whether they have available resources to finish the project as a whole, or on the other hand, they have to leave the project wholly and exclusively. Where projects cannot be done in part, the optimal combination can only be found by trial and error. So as we have discussed earlier also, whenever the management is facing the divisible project, so with the optimal combination can be found by using limiting factor analysis. PI index, profitability index is going to be used in the case of divisible projects in order to find the optimal solution. But when the organization is facing indivisible projects, then the optimal solution or the optimal combination has to be found using the trial and error. What is trial and error? They are going to find, the management is going to find different kinds of combinations in which the projects can be carried on. Whichever is going to give, then the highest NPV would be the optimal combination. Say, for example, quick overview we are going to give to this particular illustration. We are going to combine two projects, any of the two projects, or any single project if the available resources will be all spent on that particular project. And we are going to see that which project is giving us the highest NPV, which combination is giving us the highest NPV. Whichever is giving us the highest combination, highest optimal solution, we are going to go for that. So as you can see, the requirement of the question, determine the optimal project selection. On the top, they have written indivisible projects. In examination, you will not be given a heading. In scenario, they are going to give you this information that the projects are indivisible. Organization either has to take the project in entirety or has to leave it. A company has the same problem as before, but this time the projects are indivisible. So they're just continuing the previous illustration. The information is reproduced below. A company has 100,000 available for investment. So the total amount of resources which are available are 100,000 only. The total amount of investment available is 100,000. So limitation is present. A company has 100,000 available for investment and has identified the following five investments in which to invest. All investments must be started now, that is at year zero. So the limiting factor is that there is lesser investment. Company has so many positive projects in front of it, but they cannot go as per the increase in the shareholders' wealth as the resources to invest are less, are limited. Now 100,000 is there, but on different projects we require different amounts of investment. Say for example, in project C we require 40,000, on project D we do require full of 100,000, in project E 50,000, and project F 60. We are straight away going to ignore project G as it is having negative NPV. So at the first hand it is going to be ignored. Now the company has to decide that which one is the optimal combination by combining any of the two projects or undertaking any one full project, how much optimal combination profit company can make. So say for example, if the company invests in project C only, then out of 100,000 available resources, 40,000 will be used in project C. So how much is remaining? 60,000. So the company can invest in project C, and how much NPV would be there? 20,000 NPV could be generated. So the organization has an option to combine any other project with the project number C. So the company can combine project E with project C. How much investment is required in project E? 50,000. And remaining 10,000 is still left. But there is no such project in which this 10,000 can be invested because the projects are indivisible. Either the full amount has to be spent, otherwise the project should not be taken as it could not be completed. So the NPV from project E would be how much? $24,000. So the total NPV generated from this particular combination would be 44,000. By combining project C and E, the total optimal combination profit which can be attained is 44,000. Okay, now on the other hand, the company may have an option to take project C and project F2. Am I right? So total amount is 100,000. Out of this 100,000, 40,000 can be given to project C. The remaining amount is 60,000. Now the 60,000 can be spent on project F. And remaining amount is zero. So none of the investment would be lost. The NPV from project C is? Yes, dear. Good morning. The NPV from project C is 20,000. And NPV from project F is 18,000. So how much total NPV is there? 38,000. So by combining C and F, we are getting lesser NPV, lesser combined NPV as compared to the combination of C and E. So we can make any other combination. We can go by investing all of the amount in project D also, because total of project D is requiring 100,000. So 100,000 is there. If we are going to spend it on project D, total of 100,000 would be gone. Zero investment is there. And NPV generated would be how much from project D? 35,000. So which one is the optimal combination?
The first one.
By combining project C and project E, the company can get the highest amount of profit. So this is how we are going to generate the optimal combination by trial and error. By using trial and error, by combining different types of projects, we are going to find the optimal combination. Now, the problem when we are going to combine the project C and E is that remaining 10,000 is going to be lost, because we do assume that the remaining amount of capital which is not invested is going to be bring in the NPV, which is directly equal to the cost of capital. So that is not giving us any extra advantage. So here the problem is present, but still the organization can look to invest this amount in any other source so that to generate good NP. So anyhow, as per this understanding, the optimal combination is going to be got by combining project C and
last time we have seen that we will use the project which is giving.
We are going to
use the project which is giving ultimately
highest NP.
So we will use first that. But here we will use the combination of
those. Yes, we are going to combine. Because over here, if you are going to look straight away, 35,000 is the highest NPV which we are getting. We can prioritize it. And if we are going to see the PI index, obviously, we will be getting this one giving the highest PI to us. So that is not going to work in this situation. When the projects are indivisible, we have to go for the optimal combination. And that one is going to be processed by using trial and error approach. Got it? Have a look at this understanding. Harsher, in the case of indivisible projects, we are going to follow trial and error approach. We are going to see the combinations of different projects, and whichever combination is giving us the highest NPV, we are going to accept that. So in indivisible projects, the problem is that either we can complete the project in entirety, or we are not allowed to pursue that project at all. So say, for example, if we have a limited investment of 100,000, as in this case, we do have an option to invest in project C, and remaining 60,000 can be invested in either E or in project F. If the organization would want to go for C and D, it would not be possible because 40,000 is required for project C, and then remaining 100,000 is required for project D, which would not be possible. So the organization would be wanting to go for that particular combination, which will be consecutively giving it the highest NPV. So this is going to be followed by using the trial and error approach. So first we have tried to combine C and D, in which remaining 10,000 investment is going to be left. And the NPV, which we are going to get by combining C and E, would be 44,000. Then we have tried to combine C and F, in which the investment left would be zero, but the NPV which we are going to get will be 38,000. Then we have tried to go for D only because the total investment required in D is itself 100,000. So 100,000 is giving us the NPV of 35,000. So by this trial and error approach, we have found that the optimal combination is this 44,000. C and
D. Last one, what is the 150?
Last one is 100,000 investment has been available, and on project D, the investment required was 100,000. So we are left with nothing, and the NPV of project D is 35,000. Got it? Anshika, are you cleared?
Yes, miss, I understood.
Okay, now they say the key in the examination is to ascertain whether or not the projects are divisible. Divisible projects can be ranked using PI, profitability index. Combinations of indivisible projects must be considered on the trial and error basis. So in examination, if they say you that the projects under consideration are divisible, then you are going to use which approach? If the projects are divisible, we are going to use PI approach. If the projects are indivisible, we are going to use trial and error approach. Okay, now, sometimes there are situations in which we are faced with the other kind of limitation. That is, the projects under consideration are mutually exclusive projects. Mutually exclusive projects means that we can pursue one project at one time. If the investment is made in one project, we cannot invest in the other project. Maybe because the organization has limited resources, or maybe there is an opportunity cost. If by investing in the other project, organization is going to lose heavy amount of the other opportunity. So sometimes the organizations do face the situation in which they are mutually exclusive projects. One project can be taken at one time. What your book says, sometimes the taking on of the projects will preclude the taking on of another. That is, they both require use of the same asset. In these circumstances, each combination of investments is tried to identify which earns the higher level of returns. So in that case, when we are faced with the mutually exclusive projects, we can make the decisions by having a look at the highest NPV or by choosing the projects again with the optimal selection of combination. So they say the requirement of this question is determine the optimal project selection. Let's read the scenario. Using the same company information for A company, divisible projects. Now this time, these are divisible projects. The additional factor to be considered is that project C and E are mutually exclusive. So out of these all projects, project C and E are mutually exclusive. We can make the combinations of different projects, but C and E cannot be run at the same time. They are mutually exclusive. The information is reproduced below. A company has 100,000 available for investment, the same scenario, and has identified the following five investments in which to invest. All investments must be started now, that is from year zero. Now, you have to make the optimal combination, but considering that C and E cannot be taken once at the same time. Can you try this question? Try to make the optimal combination, but keep in mind that whenever you are making the combination, do not keep C and E in one combination. Make the combination of C and E. You can make the combination of C and F. You can make the combination of E and F, etc. Got it? The projects are divisible. The remaining investment can be invested to complete some part of the project. Make different types of combinations. They have given us the PIs also. Which one is on the top? Project D. Second priority is to project E. Third one is to project D. And the fourth one is to on project F. So on the last, priority will be given to the project F. So make different combinations. Okay. Just try with project C and D. Total amount of investment available is 100,000. On the top it's written. If project C is going to be taken, how much investment will be used in there? 40,000. Remaining is 60,000. If the organization does want to take project B, how much would be invested over there? 100,000. But organization does have only 60,000. Zero investment, and how much of the project B would be completed then? 60%. So 60% of B would be completed. NPV from project C is how much? 20,000.
Can we do this combination like if in case like we cannot spend 100%, like we don't have the full resources, so we can partial resources, we can invest?
Yes, because this is the divisible project. So partially we are spending it over here. That's why the project D would be finished only 60%. So the NPV which we are going to gain from project D would be 60% of its NPV. 35,000 multiplied by 60%. How much it would be?
21,000.
So the total NPV would be how much? 41,000. Got it? So if we are going to combine project C and D, we are going to get the NPV of 41,000. Now make another combination. C and E cannot be made because these are mutually exclusive. So E and D can be made. Sorry? No, these are divisible projects. So first investment E,
okay.
then remaining can be on project D. Otherwise, if full is going to be spent on project D, then obviously we will not be having any other resources. John, how much did you get? 41.5. Okay. So the NPV from the mix of E and D is? E and D is how much? 41,500. Okay. Now make the other combination if you want. E and F you can make. Done. How much?
39,000.
Yeah. Okay, the last combination which you can make is C and F. How much it is? 40. C and F?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
No, I thought it was 38.
Sorry?
38,000?
So which one is the optimal combination? E and D. With the help of trial and error, again, we have actually for in the case of divisible projects, trial and error is not the fundamental. We use PI. So by having the PI, look at the PI, then we have tried to found the trial and error approach by finding the optimal combination. Got it? So now this is. Okay, now we are expanding the discussion regarding the mutually exclusive projects. It's a multiple choice question, and the requirement is that if the objective of Select Public Limited Companies is the maximization of shareholders' wealth, which projects, if any, should it accept? Okay. So the maximization of the shareholders' wealth is the objective. So which projects should be accepted? Select Public Limited Company has calculated the following NPVs in relating to its two mutually exclusive projects X and Y. Either X can be taken or the Y can be taken. From the project X, the NPV which is generated is 100,000, and from Y, the NPV which has been generated is 35,000. NPV per dollar invested for project X is 50, and for project Y is 24,000. Which project should be accepted? Which one?
X.
Because NPV at cost of capital of 10% is higher as compared to project Y, and even NPV per dollar invested, the NPV is higher in the case of project X. So obviously, project X needs to be selected because these are two mutually exclusive projects. Otherwise, though both of them are giving the NPV, positive NPV, both can be selected. But since they are mutually exclusive projects and behind this investment, the agenda is to increase shareholders' wealth. So whenever the shareholders' wealth has to be increased with this agenda, when the investment is being made in all the positive NPV projects, the investment has to be made. But since these are mutually exclusive, we cannot go for both. So which project has to be selected? Project X only. Option C is the
Investment NPV percentage. That mm-hmm. same thing we are taking it like the percentage of investment to NPV. Is this?
No, on both the cases. positive NPV, as you do remember, that whenever the positive NPV is being calculated, we can invest in that particular project. Obviously, this one, earning per share, you can say, or earning per investment, you can say, it is also the higher one. On both the basis, whenever the agenda is to increase the shareholders, well, on both the basis, the decision is going to be made. So particularly, if both of these are not mutually exclusive projects, then both should be undertaken. But because we are mentioning two are mutually exclusive, that is why only X has selected, because it is giving us the higher NPV. Got it? Okay, now, understanding 10 and understanding 11, you can just do it as your homework, okay? Two illustrations to understand it. Now, students, the next chapter we are going to start, that is investment appraisal under uncertainty. Sometimes, or most of the times, or usually and frequently, organizations do face these situations which are uncertain. Forecasts which have to be made, or the projections which have to be made, are related to such a time period which is uncertain. Organizations do have to take a risk in every situation. The forecasts which are being made are always going to have an implied condition of uncertainty and risks involved. So now we are going to deal with the situations where NPV concept is going to be applied in the case of risk and uncertainty. What we are going to do in this chapter, we are going to learn about the concept of uncertainty and risk, that we do use these terms normally interchangeably. We are using both of these terms for the same concept, that whenever something is not sure, it is uncertain. Whenever something is not sure, we are taking a risk. So interchangeably, we do use these terms, but what is the difference among these? In the case of uncertainty, in order to be making most correct decisions, we do go for sensitivity analysis. We are going to read this, we are going to learn about application of sensitivity analysis, and we are going to learn about the strengths and weaknesses of this approach. Then we are going to discuss about the risk and the concept of expected values in the case of risk. In the case of risk, the approach is, in order to be most certain, or in order to decrease risk, the approach which we do use is expected value, that is the combination of probability and outcomes. So we are going to discuss about this concept, and the other methods which we are going to use in the case of risk are simulation, adjusted payback. We have actually used this approach, payback method, but that has not been the discounted one. We did not discount the cash flows when we used the method of payback. Now over here, we are going to consider the time value of money in the payback method also. This is going to become an adjusted payback. We are going to discuss about the risk-adjusted discount rates. We are going to discuss about the discounted payback. And we are going to discuss about the strengths and weaknesses of the different models too. Okay, now, first, let's start our discussion by having a look at the difference between risk and uncertainty. My dear students, there is a slight difference among risk and uncertainty. Whenever we are talking about risk, it is quantifiable. We are able to see that how much risk is present. We are able to express it into quantitative terms. Whenever we are speaking about uncertainty, we are not able to give any kind of quantity to it. We are able to say that this much percentage of risk is present. But when we are trying to tell someone about uncertainty, we are not able to express it into any quantitative terms. We are not able to tell that this much amount of uncertainty is present. So as they say, risk is quantifiable and uncertainty is unquantifiable. So risk is possible outcomes have associated probabilities, thus allowing the use of mathematical techniques. So since risk is quantifiable, that is why we can use mathematical and statistical approaches to look into this concept. We are able to quantify it by using the mathematical expressions. As far as uncertainty is concerned, outcomes cannot be mathematically modeled. We are not able to express uncertainty by using any kind of mathematical operations. So they say investment appraisal faces the following problems. We do know that investment appraisal has a lot of problems also. So some of the common problems which are faced under the investment appraisal are: all decisions are based on forecasts. Because whenever the investment opportunity has to be judged, we have to make forecasts about the future. And whenever we are looking into the future, the concept of risk and uncertainty arises. So all the decisions are based upon the forecast. All the forecasts are subject to uncertainty. Future is uncertain. This uncertainty needs to be reflected in the financial evaluation. Risk is represented by the variability of the potential results. Whatever outcomes we have forecasted, it's not mandatory that those same outcomes are going to be present also. There can be variability among those. So risk is represented by the variability of the potential returns. Within investment appraisals, the decision maker must also distinguish between risk and uncertainty. So risk is quantifiable, whereas uncertainty is not quantifiable. In certain investment appraisals, the areas of concern are therefore the accuracy of the estimates concerning project life. We do make the estimate regarding the life of the project that has to be accurate enough. Predicted cash flows and associated probabilities. If we have predicted any kind of cash inflows and outflows, what are the probabilities of those cash flows to happen, to occur in actual? And discount rate used. We do use the discount rate on the basis of the best knowledge available. But how actually well it is representing the actual situation, is it able to cope up with the concept of risk and uncertainty? We have to consider it. That is why further we are going to consider that the adjusted discount rate is going to be used, risk adjusted discount rate. And this concept we are going to continue up to the end of the financial management syllabus. Towards the end, we have a full one, you can say, broad topic regarding this discount rate, how we are going to incorporate the concept of risk into it. So are you cleared up to here? Okay, now, investment appraisal under uncertainty. As we have discussed that the future forecasts are going to have an element of risk and uncertainty in them, how are we going to deal with them? So different mathematical approaches and non-mathematical approaches will be used to deal with uncertainty and risk. As uncertainty is not quantifiable, so that is why non-mathematical approaches are going to be used in order to deal with uncertainty. Whereas risk is quantifiable, that is why mathematical expressions will be used in order to deal with risk. So under uncertainty, we are going to have a look at different concepts like set a minimum payback period, make prudent. Prudent means careful. Make prudent estimates of cash flows to assess the worst possible situation, assess both best and worst possible situations to obtain a range of NPVs, use sensitivity analysis to measure the margin of safety on input data. So sensitivity analysis is going to be used particularly in the case of uncertainty situation. So as you can see, all of the methods over here which are mentioned are not going to give us any kind of mathematical approach. Mathematical approaches cannot be used in order to ascertain uncertainty. Whereas the risk is concerned, we can say that mathematical approaches or expressions can be used to deal with it. So the approaches which we are going to follow here are expected values, simulation models. Simulation is related to the sensitivity analysis, adjusted payback, risk adjusted discount rates. So these four approaches particularly we are going to look in the case of risk. So one by one, we are going to deal with all of them. Now, first we are going to start with the sensitivity analysis. Whenever we are required to analyze the sensitivity of any project, it means that we want to see that if one variable is changed, what is the effect of it on all of the project? Say, for example, when you use spreadsheets, in spreadsheets, when you are deploying any kind of models, business models are being made, then sensitivity analysis is applied over there. That by changing variable cost, what is the effect on all of the project? By changing sales value, what is the effect on all of the project? So by changing one variable, what is the effect on all of the project is known as sensitivity analysis. So what your book says about it, sensitivity analysis typically involves posing what if questions. What if one variable is going to be changed? What will be the effect on all of the project? And in Excel spreadsheets, you might know that we have what if functions also. So they are particularly deployed in order to see the effect on all of the project by changing one variable. I'm repeating, by changing one variable, what is the effect on all of the project? Because in sensitivity analysis, we do see the effect by changing only one variable. When there is simulation, that is the other one which will be used in the risk approaches, over there, by changing different variables, what is the effect on the overall project? So in sensitivity analysis, what if one variable is going to be changed in the overall situation? So they say, for example, what if demand fell by 10% compared to our original forecast? Would the project still be viable? So if 10% demand of the product is going to be reduced, what is going to be the effect for that? Then ideally, we want to know how much demand could fall before the project should be rejected, or equivalently, the break-even demand that gives an NPV of zero, that is IRR. We could then assess the likelihood of the forecast demand being that low. So what is going to be the effect if some things are going to happen? So how are we going to apply the sensitivity analysis in order to calculate the sensitivity margin? The formula which we do use is NPV divided by a present value of the cash flows under consideration. By applying this method, we are going to see that with how much percentage a certain thing is going to increase or fall in order to convert our positive NPV to the negative NPV. So present value of the cash flows under consideration, this can be anything, say for example, cost. When we are dividing NPV with the cost, it is going to tell us that how much cost is going to be increased in order to convert the positive NPV into the negative one, or how much cost is going to be increased in order to decrease the NPV of the project. So this denominator, present value of the cash flows under consideration, can be anything about which we do want to analyze the situation. So NPV of the total project is going to be divided by the present value of the cash flows under consideration multiplied by 100. They say the maximum possible change is often expressed as a percentage. This would be calculated for each input individually, as I have elaborated. The lower the sensitivity margin, the more sensitive the decision to the particular parameter being considered. That is, small changes in the estimate could change the project decision from accept to reject. So if you are giving the answer to the sensitivity margin in the lower percentage, it means that higher sensitivity is involved. By just changing a few percentages, the project is going to be converted into the some other decision. And B, because we will need the present value of each cash flow separately, the following tabular approach is preferred layout for the NPV calculation. So you can neglect it, otherwise they are just mentioned in this layout. You can make first mention the time, then cash flow description, then discount factor and X, that what is our value under consideration and present value is going to be find out. Are you clear up to here? The formula for calculating sensitivity margin is NPV divided by present value of the cash flows under consideration. Now, my dear students, understanding number one is there. You are required to calculate the NPV of this investment. First, you are required to calculate the NPV of the investment. Then you are required to calculate the sensitivity of your calculation to the following. So once NPV is going to be calculated, then you are going to apply the formula, that is NPV divided by initial investment, NPV divided by selling price, NPV divided by variable cost, in order to see the sensitivity margin in all of these situations. Let's read the scenario. An investment of $40,000 today, it is in current terms, is expected to give rise to annual contributions. Students, what is contribution? No. What is the formula for contribution?
Sales minus cost.
Sales minus variable cost. Sales minus variable cost is contribution. Okay, so they say today is expected to give rise to the annual contribution of $25,000. This is based on selling one project with a sales volume of 10,000 units, selling price of $12.5 and variable cost per unit of $10. Annual fixed cost of $10,000 will be incurred for the next 4 years. So the life of the project is 4 years. The discount rate is 10%. The students, can you quickly calculate the NPV? Can you quickly calculate the NPV? calculate the NPV, then we are going to move on. To make a table, represent the cash flows, mention the time, apply the discounting factor, calculate the NPV. Do you have formula table with you?
Yes.
Okay, that could be used in order to calculate anything. Yes, dear. Sorry. Sorry.
0, 1, 2, 3.
No, the sales would be starting from year 1. 1 to 4.
Investment
in year 0. In current terms, investment is always in year 0. Currently, we are investing it. In year 0, we have an investment 40,000, discount factor at 10%, it will be 1. So present value would be 40,000. There is no inflation or anything else. The contribution is going to remain the same from year 1 to 4. We have the contribution of how much? 25,000. See the NVT factor at year 4, 10% year 4. At year 4, 10% at year 4, NVT factor.
Yeah.
3.17. Calculate the present value. $79,250. Then we have fixed cost. Students, you can separately calculate the selling price and variable cost too. But I have collectively calculated contribution. Okay. Okay. Then fixed cost, annual fixed cost of 10,000 will be incurred for the next 4 years. From year 1 to 4, fixed cost is there 10,000. The same equity factor is going to be applied year 4. How much it is?
$31,700.
Now calculate the NPV.
$7,550.
So we have calculated the NPV. Now calculate the sensitivity of your calculation to the following. So first calculate the sensitivity to this initial investment. NPV divided by initial investment. NPV divided by initial investment multiplied by 100, sensitivity margin. 7,550 divided by initial investment, 40,000 multiplied by 100. How much it is?
18.87%.
18.87%, or you can just say 19%. So it means that initial investment, the cost of the initial investment will be increased by at least 19% in order to convert the NPV into zero, in order to make the project as at zero level. Now, do for the selling price per unit. Need to use the selling price 12.5. How much total units are there? 10,000.
Yeah.
Where is it written? Yes, on the top, 10,000. And then you need to convert it into the present value also. We have converted contribution into the present value, but we need to convert the sales also into the present value. Same discounting factor is going to be used.
396,250.
Now use this NPV divided by selling price per unit. Like this, do it all.
So this one you have to.
Sorry?
Discount you have.
Yes. The same you are going to do for variable cost. For sales volume, students, use contribution. Because sales volume affects both the variable cost and the sales price. So use the contribution for sales volume. Are you cleared or you do have any confusion? Cleared?
We can do in the table formula using this calculator individually.
Yes, individually. These are the separate parts. Individually.
There's a discount commission to a discount value
cost. Just calculate the present value and just use the formula.
For everything I do a discount? Yeah.
No.
For
yes, the one which we have not discounted, because for selling price per unit we did not have discounted before. We had discounted contribution only.
But we have variable cost again.
Variable cost again. For sales volume, you will be using contribution. Do not discount it. Use this one. Because we have already discounted it. Fixed cost, do not discount it. Use this discounted one. So this one is 18.87. What about the second one? What did you get? 1.91. What about this? 2.38. Sales volume, take contribution. This contribution, 79250. 9.5. Fixed cost. 23.8. Okay, then discount rate.
How do we improve the discount rate?
This 10%.
7551.0.1.
Yes. No. Think about this. Have you done all of the previous ones?
Yeah.
Okay, we are going to look for it. Write the reason also, because in the exam You will not only be required to calculate, you have to tell them what we have analyzed by calculating these. The initial investment, if the cost of the initial investment is going to be increased by 19%, then our NPV would be zero. What about the selling price per unit? If the selling price per unit is going to be decreased by 1.91%, then our NPV would be zero. So try to find the reasons also and do write it as one line statement too. And Shrika, are you cleared?
Miss, can you explain again?
Sure,
like what
sure.
You just said.
Yes, dear, when we are calculating the sensitivity margin, we need to see that what is the analysis behind it? What are the reasons behind it? So when we are changing the variable initial investment, when the cost of investment is going to be increased by around 19%, our NPV, our numerator is going to become zero. Same with the case of selling price per unit. If our selling price per unit is going to be decreased by 1.91%, from 12.5, it is going to be decreased by 1.91%, our NPV would become zero. So these are the reasons behind it. Variable cost per unit, if it is going to be increased by 2.38%, our NPV would become zero. So these are the reasons.
How do you understand the significance?
Sorry?
How do you understand the significance?
Because the cost is going to be increased, only then the NPV has to be zero. Selling price is going to be decreased, then the NPV has to be zero. Got it?
We need to keep in mind that we need to bring the NPV to zero.
Yes, this is sensitivity, that how much change in a particular factor is going to be brought in to convert the NPV to zero, to break even. This is sensitivity. Let me check.
The discount, we have.
Harsha, did you get? Yes, yes. Harsha, did you get the same answers? Let me check. So you can round them up. Yes, yes, 23.8. Yes, yes. Okay, now students, for this discount rate, try to find it by yourself. Use the IRR technique. Because IRR is the discount rate at which the NPV of the project is zero. Find the IRR, then compare that IRR to this discount rate.
You
cannot use the formula of IRR over here. Do use the tabular approach. Dio, do the backward working. May I erase it? Do the backward working to calculate this IRR because you do not have enough data for that. So do the backward working. Present value of the investment is 40,000. That is investment present value.
That one, the negative positive, that one.
I don't know what which thing you are talking about. Discount factor has been one for this one. Now, the present value of your cash flows must be 40,000 in order to bring the NPV at zero. Got it? The present value of your cash flows must be 40,000. Cash inflows must be 40,000 in order to bring your NPV at zero. At which particular discount factor the cash flows would be 40,000? You need to find it. So this discounting factor, which is going to be over here, is IRR. Okay. What are your cash flows? What are your total cash flows?
Total cash flows.
25,000 is the contribution and fixed cost is 10,000. Okay, simplify it. 25,000 minus 10,000, it is 15,000. Your cash flows in collection are 15,000. Okay, now let me just. Now, what would be the discounting factor over here? How can you find it? Yes, divide, then you are going to find the discounting factor.
Two point six seven.
That is the discounting factor at which you are going to get the present value of the cash flows at 40,000. Now use your present value table to find. Ansika, are you clear up to here?
Miss, can you take a picture of the board?
Sorry?
Can you take a picture of the board?
Sure, dear, sure. What is the life of the project, students?
Now 4 years.
4 years, sorry?
3 years.
4 years. 4 years.
6%. 6%. And 3 years.
Can you give me one table because I did not do it? Please check. And Sneha, I'm sending you the picture here. Let me just finish it. At
okay.
4 years.
Yes.
Dear, 4 years.
No, in table is 3 years. 2.67.
No. Which one?
2.67 factor.
In 4 years. Look the cost of capital, which is nearer to 2.67 in your table at 4 years. This is what we have done in our NPV in detail, my dear students. You have forgot the idea.
No, 18%. 18%.
Not
18. So what, 2.67, right? Yeah, 18%.
18%. So our discounting factor at which our NPV would be zero is 18%. Got it? This is the same sort of question we have done the earlier was. So now, find the NVT factor. I'm writing it for Angelica. NVT factor nearest to 2.67. That is 18%. Now, how much change in the discount rate is going to be brought in order to make the NPV as zero? 18% change. 18% is the discount rate at which our NPV is zero. How much change we are going to brought in to the discount rate in order to? Let me just enter. I think I've done it roughly. I hope it's gonna work for you. Okay. So are you clear about the concept of sensitivity analysis now? Okay, now students, just read this theory part quickly. What are the advantages and disadvantages of the sensitivity analysis? Advantages are simple, that this is very simple to be applied, then provides more information to allow management to make subjective judgments. Students, what is the meaning of subjective judgment? The one
based on opinion,
personal input, biasness, personal opinions are brought in. So provides more information to allow management to make subjective judgments. They would be able to make the changes in their decisions on the basis of the sensitivity analysis. Identifies critical estimates. So whenever the critical estimates are going to be made in using sensitivity analysis, we would be able to analyze them. What can be the disadvantages? Assumes variable change independently of each other. So each of the variable change separately is going to be analyzed in the case of sensitivity analysis, because it helps us to analyze the changes by changing one variable at a time. Does not assess the likelihood of a variable changing. Okay, so it is not, we are not able to assess the likelihood of a variable changing in the case of sensitivity analysis, as we have discussed, as we have seen in our last example too. Does not directly identify a correct decision. So we are able to calculate the sensitivity margin, and we are able to discuss the changes in the particular variables which are going to change our NP, but correct decision cannot be reached with the help of the sensitivity analysis. Now, my dear students, the next approach is probability analysis, and probability analysis is used in the cases of uncertainty. Or risk. In the case of risk, we do use probability analysis. In the case of uncertainty, the one approach, sensitivity analysis, is going to be used, which we have discussed earlier. Now, what is probability analysis? What is the meaning of probability? The likelihood of something to occur, something to happen, is known as probability. In financial reporting terms, we do say that whenever there are chances of more than 50% of certain thing to happen, is known as a probable item. So what is probability analysis? We are going to see the likelihood of the different items or the cash flows under consideration, that what is the likelihood of them to occur. So we are going to analyze it. So what your book says about it, when there are several possible outcomes for a decision and probabilities can be assigned to each, a probability distribution of expected cash flows can often be estimated, recognizing there are several possible outcomes, not just one. So they have told us that how can we use this approach. Calculate an expected value. My dear students, expected value is probability multiplied by x. How are we going to calculate expected value? It is the function of probability into x. So probability of each and every cash flow to happen is expected value. So first we are going to calculate an expected value. We are going to measure the risk by calculating the worst possible outcome and its probability, calculating the probability that the project will fail, for example, that a negative NPV will result, and part C, assessing the standard deviation of the outcome. My dear students, we are not going to do all of these in our syllabus. It is not all involved. Up till here only, we are going to do the discussion. Anyhow, let's see how is it going to be applied. No. And trust me, in examination also, the particular area which you need to consider is the investment appraisal simplified question, which we have discussed earlier. Incorporation of taxation, incorporation of working capital, incorporation of, what is the third thing? Inflation, I have forgot. Yes, so inflation, we are going to, that is going to be the particular key area which is going to be examined. Anyhow, the expected value is the weighted average of all possible outcomes with the weightings based on the probability estimates. So when we do multiply probability of each outcome with every cash flow, we are actually getting the weighted average of all the cash flows. So this is expected value. The standard deviation, if you recall your previous earlier studies in F2, you have discussed about standard deviation, that is the under root of variation. The standard deviation is the next step, is the next statistical measure to calculate the expected value, to work on the expected value. Standard deviation is the statistical measure of the variability of the distribution around its mean. That when we do calculate the weighted average mean, how effectively that mean is representing all of our data is known as standard deviation. How accurately our mean is representing all of the population under consideration is standard deviation. So standard deviation is the statistical measure of the variability of the distribution around the mean. That is, it measures the dispersion of possible outcomes about the expected value. The tighter the distribution, the lower this measure will be. It is a measure of risk. The wider the dispersion, the riskier the situation. If our standard deviation is getting larger, it means that our calculated answer is more riskier. It is involving more risk because our calculated mean is not effectively representing all of the population. So anyhow, you will be required to calculate expected value. Standard deviation is not included in our F9 syllabus. Now, probability analysis and expected value calculation. The formula for calculating an expected value is EV is equal to sigma PX, where P is the probability of an outcome and X is the value of an outcome. So simply the cash flows under consideration would be X and P is the probability of each outcome, which will be given to you straight away in the question. The expected value is not the most likely result. It may not even be possible result, but instead it finds the long run average outcome. So expected value is not the most, you know, occurring event, or it is not the event which is most, you know, it's most possible for that event to occur, but it's simply the arithmetical mean or the average of all the results which are occurring. Now here is understanding number three, my dear students. Requirement of the question is to determine which project should be selected on the basis of expected market values. On the basis of expected market values, you have to select the best project. Let's read the scenario. A firm has to choose between three mutually exclusive projects. So any one of the project can be done at one time. The outcomes of which depends upon the state of the economy. The following estimates have been made. Okay, so we have three projects under consideration, project A, project B, and project C. And three states of the economies are also given: recession, stability, and growing. So in these three conditions, we are being given the probabilities also. And we have to see that which one should need to be selected by using the expected values. Can you go for that? For every project, you simply have to apply the formula that is C into X. Can you try to do it? First, take project A. It's very simple, students. First, take project A. And project A has three conditions: state of economy, recession, stable, growing. And you have to multiply probability, that is P, into outcomes. Outcome is X. So under recession for project A, what is the probability?
0.5.
For stable, for project A, what is the probability?
0.4.
What is the outcome for recession and probability of 0.5 for project A? 100, then 200, then 1,400. Can you calculate the expected value? P into X, 0.5 multiplied by 100. Then, 80. Sorry, 80. Then
140.
How much is the expected value?
This is 270.
Okay, like this, calculate the expected value for all the projects. Since you do it, I'm just coming. I'm coming in 5 minutes.
Pleasure to invite Mr. King Father of the prison.
So Harshit, have you finished?
Yeah.
Okay, what is the expected value for project B then?
260.
260, okay.
186 C.
Great. And did Atif get the same results?
I don't know.
Okay. Anjalika, what about you? What is the expected value for project B?
For project B, I got the same.
Okay, and what about project C?
B, and then for C, it's 186.
Very good. So on the basis of expected values, which project is going to be taken? Project A, having the highest expected value. Harshad, you can start doing this. Harshad and Anjalika, both of you can start doing this question. Quickly do it. It's just for a practice, okay? On the same basis. Should the investment be undertaken? Again, on the basis of expected values. Think of a way to do it?
No, it's nothing.
It's very simple, yes. Quickly calculate the expected value first. First calculate the expected value, then calculate the NPV of the project.
Just look to the model, right?
Sorry?
Experiment value.
I have. Let me just check. Expected value is how much? No. 50,000 multiplied by 0.3, 100,000 multiplied by 0.5.
Sorry, 91,000. 95,000.
95,000.
I thought 95,000.
The investment is already given. Cash flows we have found. Expected value. The selling value is 40,000. Using the discounting factor, calculate the present values. Investment at year zero. We have 460,000. Discounting factor is 5%. The life of the project is 5 years. So from year 1 to 5, cash flow, yes, it's 95,000. Apply the annuity factor of year 5. Calculate the present value. For year 5, then we have a scrap value. $40,000. Be careful, students. Over here, you are going to apply the present value. Present value at present value table, you are going to see the scrap value. This one is NVT.
Yeah.
This one is NVT. This one is not NVT.
The 1 to 5
is
5%, right?
Yes, discounted factor is 5%.
So 4.3 to 9.
4.3 to 9. Okay, the present value table for year 5.
0.74.
Sorry?
Should we close the
table? Switch off? Yes, sure. Why not? Adit, did you finish the previous question?
Yeah.
Okay. Just tell me what expected values did you get? Cross check with Harshad because I have checked with Harshad. For project B?
260. That's the same question.
260 or 180? 186. 186 for the last one. There may be any kind of calculation error, maybe. Okay, now Atif, we have started doing this question.
0.784, right?
0.784? For you, 5 from present value table, 0.784?
50 is 5%, right?
Okay, so after this is based upon the same concept, should the investment be undertaken or not? So Drelin companies considering an investment of 460,000 in a non-current asset expected to generate substantial cash inflows over the next 5 years. These are the cash flows. Unfortunately, the annual cash flows from this investment are uncertain, but the following probability distribution has been established. So for cash flows, just calculate the expected value. We have got an expected value of 95,000. After calculating this expected value, we are just going to calculate the present value. We are going to calculate the NPV at last, and we are going to suggest that whether the project should be undertaken or not. Which one? NPV?
Yeah.
Okay, 17385, let me check.
This is checking this
one. Yes, 17385 negative.
Yeah. So we won't take the project.
I think we have taken the cash flow amount of 95,000. We have taken an NVD factor.
Yeah.
The point which you need to be clear, careful, and in exam also, my dear students, in year 5, we have a scrap value, but this is not an NVG. This is not a repetitive amount. So use the present value table in this case. For year 5, see the present value table at 5%. Okay, do it.
Yeah,
got it? No. May I erase it? Anjalika, what NPV did you get?
Negative 17385.
Okay. Are you clear?
Yeah, miss.
Okay. Okay, now students, what are the strengths and weaknesses of probability analysis? Strength is that it deals with multiple outcomes. So as we have seen, the different outcomes will be under consideration, and probability analysis deals with those, with the likelihoods or likelihood of all those outcomes. Quantifies probabilities. It actually gives a quantifiable term to the probabilities, to the likelihoods of the events of occurring. Relatively simple calculation as compared to the other sensitivity analysis also. This is seemingly the simple calculation. Assists decision making. It assists the management and decision making like all the other approaches. Weaknesses, subjective probabilities. Obviously, probabilities, and they are going to be decided, it will be involving the personal biasness. How can someone tell that this is the percentage of some event to be happening? Answer is only a long run average. So the answer which we are getting, it's an average answer, it's a weighted average one, it's not the absolute one. Ignores variability of the payoffs. So payoffs can be, cash flows can be variable, but this ignores it. Risk neutral decisions, that is, ignores investors' attitude to risk. Obviously, when the investors are going to make the decisions, their personal opinion about the risk is going to be also under consideration, but this ignores it because some of the management can be risk averse, some can be, you know, happier to take more risk. So this particular probability analysis ignores the fact. Okay, now they say using expected values as the basis of decision making is appropriate if three conditions are nearly met. So when we are using expected values, we need to see that if these particular conditions are being met, then it's possible or it's good, it's better to apply the expected values approach. Otherwise, do neglect it. There is a reasonable basis for making the forecast and estimating the probability of different outcomes. So we need to consider that how much likelihood of our particular outcomes is there. If we are near to certain about those forecasts, then it's good to have expected value under consideration. Otherwise, there is no metric which is going to indulge us using it. The decision is relatively small in relation to the business, so risk is small in magnitude. So obviously, wherever the risk is involved, we need to decrease its magnitude overall. So when the decision is small, then we can use expected values to take any kind of decision. Otherwise, do not use it. The decision is for a category of decisions that are often made. So when there are regular decisions under consideration, then it's good to use expected values. Otherwise, if there is some irregular decision under consideration and we are using expected value for the first time for that, it is not going to be a good decision. The expected value technique is best suited to a problem which is repetitive and involves relatively small investments. So those investments which are not repetitive in nature do not use expected values for them. Okay, now we are extending the topic of probability analysis and we are going to go for joint probabilities. Sometimes the events which are under consideration are more than one. Previously, we have seen the situations in which only one outcome has been happening at one time. Sometimes there are chances for loss and the profit both to happen. Or we do have more than two projects, or we have more than one project under consideration, and we do have different probabilities or different likelihoods for those to happen. So in those cases, instead of using single probabilities, we have to calculate the probability for those events jointly. So under probability analysis, now we have joint probabilities topic in consideration. They say a joint probability may be described as the probability of one thing and another thing happening. So whenever we have more than one events under consideration, we will be going for joint probabilities. The single probability or the probability in isolation tells us a probability of one thing or another thing happening. But in this case, joint probability, two things happening at the same time, but is the joint probability, joint likelihood of those events to occur. So they are explaining the fact over here. We are going to see the first one. For instance, if the probability of the business bank account having a positive cash flow in the month one is 20%. And the probability of it having a positive cash flow in month two is 40%. So in 2 months, there are probabilities given. What would be the joint probability? 0.2 multiplied by 0.4. The joint probability is 88%. So they say, then the joint probability of it having a positive cash flow in both months, month one and month two, can be found by multiplying the individual probabilities together. So simply by multiplying the individual probabilities together, we can get the joint probability.
So if one is negative and one is positive,
we are simply going, it percentage cannot be negative here, the first thing. This is a percentage. Probability can't be in minus. We cannot say that probability, the answer of the probability is always in between 0 to 1. In between 0 to 1. Got it? So if there is a zero probability, it means that event is never going to happen. If it's one, it's most certain to happen. Okay, also potentially useful is the ability to calculate the probability of one thing or another thing happening, which is, if there is a concept of or, then we are going to add. Mutually exclusive events are there. Consider the difference. Also potentially useful is the ability to calculate the probability of one thing or another thing happening, which is found by adding the individual probabilities together. For instance, the probability of positive cash flow in either month one or month two for the bank account would be calculated as 0.2 plus 0.4, that is 60%. So either one can happen or the other can happen, the probability is going to be added in order to calculate the joint probability. Now over here we have understanding number 5, in which we are required to apply the concept. Requirement of the question is to calculate the following figures: the mean present cash flow in year 1, then the mean expected present cash flow in year 2, the mean expected NPV of the investment, the probability of the investment having a negative NPV, the probability of the investment having $0 NPV. Let's read the scenario. A company has estimated cash flows for the project, incorporating the probability of each present cash flow value into its estimates as follows. So present cash flow In year one, 100,000 or 200,000 it can be, and the probability is 20% and 80%. For year two, in the same way they have mentioned, two cash flows are there, 200,000 and 300,000, and the probability is 30% and 70% respectively. The proposed investment will cost 400,000, payable in full at the start of the project. So the first requirement is to calculate the mean present cash flow in year one. What it can be, students? The mean present cash flow in year one. Can you calculate the joint probability for year one?
Yeah.
100,000 multiplied by 20% and then 200,000 multiplied by 80%. This is going to be the mean present cash flow in year one. Okay, you need to calculate in the same way the mean present cash flow in year two. Use this data in order to calculate the joint probability for year two. Then the mean expected NPV of the investment, using the investment also, then you have to do it. Okay, first two, part A and part B, for year one and for year two. What did you get for part A?
180,000.
180,000, very good. Atif, did you get the same? Okay, what about the second one?
270,000.
270,000. Okay. Then the expected value of the investment.
NPV, right?
NPV.
So both are going to be, right?
Yes, both are going to be incorporated together with this initial investment. Minus 40,000 plus and plus both.
Positive answer 50,000.
50,000?
Positive.
Yes.
Sorry. Add up this minus and follow.
Okay, so simply you have done it as minus 40,000 plus the first one, presented you the cash flows for the first one.
Sorry,
400,000. Okay. What was for the first one? Expected value? Sorry?
180,000.
270,000. How much it is in total? 50,000? Positive. Okay. Now do the D1, the probability of the investment having a negative NPV. We have different cash flows. We can have different NPVs for all the cases. Do calculate the NPVs for all the situations and tell them what is the probability of having a negative NPV. In which situation we are going to get the negative NPV.
Okay. For year one, year two, different.
No, you can have different combinations.
Oh yeah, sorry.
This can happen, or this can happen. Different things can happen.
Okay.
Make a table. Make a proper table for all of it. Let me just give you a hint, so you should not be confused.
I'll just make the table.
In table you have to, you know, make for all the probabilities. Okay, let me just give you a hint. The total cost, the total amount, that table or whichever table you want, it's particularly as per your approach. 400,000 is the total amount of investment available. In this total amount of investment, either this can be happening, 100,000, and this 300,000 can happen. So this is you have to see. The total investment is 400,000.
Okay.
then calculate the joint probabilities. In year one, this can happen, 100,000 can happen. And in year two, 200,000 can happen. This combination can be made. Then with 100,000, 300,000 can be done. Then from year one, 200,000 and 200,000 from year two can be made. Another option.
It's the same number.
200,000, sorry?
The same what you've done.
Trial and error? No, no, no. This is not trial and error. Not at all trial and error, it is. Different combinations. You are just mixing it. Actually, we do want to find the joint probability. In year one, either this can happen or either this can happen. In year two, either this can happen or this can happen. So make the combination that in year one, if this is happening, in year two, this is happening. First combination is made. Then, or the other combination, this can happen. And this can happen. Second combination is made, then come to the second outcome for year one. This can happen, and this can happen. One can happen in both the years. This can happen, and this can happen. So four combinations are being made, and calculate the joint probabilities then. Sure. Okay. Year one, year two, probability and probability. For year one, 100,000, what is the probability of that? 20% or 2. And the second combination you can take 200,000. In the next combination, we can make it 300,000, 100,000. What is the probability of this 200,000? 0.3%. Calculate the joint probabilities. Calculate the present value then. Then for the second combination, again with 100,000, the probability is 0.2. You can take 300,000. The probability is 0.3. Make the third combination with 200,000.
Is it seven?
0.7. Then for 200,000 again, 0.8%, and then 200,000 from year two, it is 0.3%. Make the fourth combination with 200,000, 0.8, and then 300,000. 0.7. Then calculate the joint probabilities and then NPVs. Yes, dear.
Joint probability is 1.1.
1 point? Joint probability for the first one? 0.8
into 0.3,
yes.
Into plus.
Sorry?
Either, right?
No. Even then the joint probability, look. Ultimately we are going to add. In that case also, look, you are confusing yourself. Here, consider it. For instance, look at this example once again. If the probability of the business bank account having a positive cash flow in month one is 20%, and the probability of it having a positive cash flow in months two is 40%. Then the joint probability of it having a positive cash flow in both months is 0.2 multiplied by 0.4. Also potentially useful is the ability to calculate the probability of one thing or another thing happening, which is found by adding the individual probabilities together. For instance, the probability of positive cash flow in either month, month one or month two, for the bank account would be calculated as 0.2 multiplied by 0.4. Over there, there has been a concept of and. Getting it now? In year one, it can happen, and it can happen in year two. So there is a joint for multiply it. This is not in either. It is not that either in year one it can happen and it can happen in year two either. Have you calculated joint probabilities?
Yeah. 0.06.
Sorry, how much?
0.06.
0.06.
0.14.
0.24.
0.24.
0.56. So you have multiplied each of these. Now, multiply present values, total present values with them. Total present values. 200 plus 100,000. 300,000. 400,000. 500,000. Now, total present values multiplied by joint probabilities.
18,000.
Positive?
Positive.
Okay, then?
Other positive, no?
Okay, yes.
Yeah, and then we go for 56,000.
56,000.
100,000. 96,000.
Then
280,000.
Now calculate the NPVs. Calculate the present values. 400,000.
450,000.
Okay, calculate all of these and then calculate an NPV.
Which one, ma'am? I wanted to know the NPV answer, right?
Yes, yes, please.
50,000.
Sorry?
50,000.
50,000 positive? How are you calculating it?
Then adding all of them? Minus 400,000.
Minus 400,000?
Staff value nothing, ma'am.
Okay, calculate it then.
That's a difference, no? 450,000 minus 400,000.
My dear, calculate for it, then this, and then this.
Calculate.
Yes, individually calculate.
Patience. In the conclusion, you will see.
Got it?
We will deduct it from the total investment, right?
Total investment of 400,000 deduct the present values.
Okay, individual IPs.
Yes. Present values.
Oh, 4 lakh from everything.
Yes, from the present. How do you calculate present values? These are the total present values.
Yes.
These are the cash inflows. These are the cash inflows. We have calculated the total present values. Now calculate the, in order to calculate the total NPV. 400,000 is our initial investment.
Zero answer.
41st one is zero.
No, that's 100,000. -100,000.
-100,000.
And then the final one is zero.
The second one?
Zero.
Zero.
Zero. +1,000.
100,000. Got it? Now you have calculated the present values. Now see the question. The probability of the investment having the negative NPV. Which investment is having the negative NPV?
First.
So now the probability of the investment having a negative NPV 0.2 multiplied by 0.3. Getting it? We have done this only to do this question. Individually, we have calculated the NPV for different combinations. So we can come to know that which probabilities jointly will be giving us the negative ones. Got it? Now the probability of the investment having zero NPV.
Second.
Now we have two. How are we going to do it then?
Who has the?
The probability of the investment having a zero NPV.
Percentage.
This one is also having, and this one is also having, and then the joint probability added.
Yeah, so it's one.
Now this is going to be the concept of adding.
Option three.
Which one option?
Third one.
Dear, both of these combinations are going to give us the zero NPV. So what is the probability, joint probability of it? 0.2 multiplied by 0.7 plus 0.8 multiplied by 0.3.
Plus 0.8 plus 0.3, right? So 1.1 and 0.9. So it's this third one, right?
Which one, third one?
0.38.
Which the, are you selecting an option from here? The second combination and the third combination both are giving us zero NPV.
Third combination.
Second and third, both combinations.
But they're asking for one or?
No, they are not asking. The probability of the investment, the probability of the total investment giving us the zero NPV. Got it? And the probability of, if say for example we given us, give us an option, the probability of the investment having positive NPV, so here is only one, so it will be 200,000, this 0.8 multiplied by 0.7. Got it? Here there are two, so 0.2 multiplied by 0.7 plus 0.8 multiplied by 0.3. This one is and instead of, then we are comparing each other, then it is or. Then it is the concept of either. So then we are going to add both of these. So 0.2 multiplied by 0.7 plus 0.8 multiplied by
0.3.
Got it?
Yes.
So this is going to be the probability of the investment having a negative.
So we need to show this percentage, but we got 0.38%.
Which one?
In 2 plus 3. 2 plus 3. After adding now, we got 0.38.
Okay, yes, 0.38, 38%.
So this will be also for that one, 38%.
Yes, for this one, having the negative, because two investment scenarios are giving us the jointly a negative and zero. Cleared? 38%
probability of
yes. This. It's confusing, and these are the network questions. Yes, dear?
Miss, can you explain the last part again?
Which one?
The last part when you were explaining.
Part E, the probability of the investment having a zero NPV. Out of this total table, this last NPV, this one, zero NPV. Yes, two out of the totals we have zero NPV. So we are going to see the joint probabilities of these giving us the zero NPV. So 0.2 multiplied by 0.7 plus 0.8 multiplied by 0.3. Or simply 0.14 plus 0.24.
Yeah.
This is the joint probability of investments. Got it, Angelica?
Yeah, miss. Miss, can you also send me the picture?
Sorry?
Can you also send me the picture if you don't
sure,
mind?
Sure.
Thank you, miss.
Okay, now student simulation. As I told you, the simulation is interrelated to the sensitivity analysis. Only a short discussion is related to the simulation over here. Sorry, I don't know what has happened to me. Only a small difference is there in between simulation and sensitivity analysis. In the exam, you will not be required to carry on the simulation technique. You will not be required to do the questions on the simulation. But you just need to be cleared about the basic idea behind simulation. Sensitivity analysis tells us that by changing one variable, what is going to be the effect on all the situations. Simulation analysis tells us that by changing different variables, what could be the effect on the overall situation. This is the concept behind simulation. What your book says about it, sensitivity analysis considers the effect of changing one variable at a time. Simulation improves on this by looking at the impact of many variables changing at the same time. Using mathematical models, it produces a distribution of possible outcomes from the project. Probability of different outcomes can then be calculated. So expected value, my dear students, is basically a weighted average. And if we do plot NPV on the x-axis and probability on the y-axis, expected value would be in between because it is an arithmetical mean. Now, simulation model will be telling us that if we are changing the positions, how is going to be the situation overall changed? This is just a simulation technique. They have given us the method to calculate the simulation, but just forget it, it is not going to be examinable. Sorry? We want to switch. Already half is switched off. Half is already switched. Full? Because we are again going to do the questions. The questions are there. Okay, now students, adjusted payback or discounted payback. We have discussed about the questions regarding payback, and we have in advantages and disadvantages, we discussed that the major drawback of the payback period is that it ignores time value of money. When we are using the payback in the case of uncertainty or in the case of risk having situations, in those cases, we should be using discounted payback. First, we are going to convert the cash flows into their present value simply. And then we are going to calculate the cumulative cash flows out of them, and we are going to calculate the discounted payback. So the same basic approach is going to remain the same. For calculating payback, we do calculate the cumulative cash flows of the given cash flows in front of us. But first step we are going to include in over here, first we are going to calculate the present value of the cash flows given to us, then we are going to calculate the cumulative cash flows, and we are going to calculate the discounted payback. So in payback method, we just have the adjustment. We are going to convert it to the discounted payback. What your book says about it, the cash flows are first discounted using an appropriate discount rate that reflects the risk profile of the project. The cumulative discounted cash flow can then be calculated in the same manner as the cumulative cash flow is for the standard payback calculation. So the only difference is that we are going to convert the cash flows into the discounted cash flows first. The solution is already there. Okay, so this is a quick illustration. Let's have a look at this. Calculate the discounted payback. So my dear students, a project with the following cash flows is under consideration. We have 4 years project. From year zero to from year four, we have been given the cash flows. So my dear students, we have taken the negative cash flow and there is no discount factor involved in that. So cash flow is going to remain 200,000. 8,000 we have discounted it. They have just used the formula, that is 1 over 1 plus r raised to the power n, or 1 plus r raised to the power minus n. Okay, so they have just different, they made it differently. So 8,000 multiplied by 1.08, that is basically 1 plus r. Our discounting factor is 8%. So 1.08 raised to the power 1, we are selling in year 1. So we are converting it to the discounted cash flow. For all the 3 years, we have done it in the same way. Then we have calculated the cumulative cash flows like we have discussed earlier also in our previous lecture. Now over here, we do know that in between year 2 and year 3, our cash flow has been converted to the positive value. So what is the formula to do that? 2305 divided by 3175. Whatever we are going to get, we are going to round it off. So what are we going to get? 2 years, 3 months, or they have simply taken it as 2.73 years. Whatever you want to do. Okay, no. 2.73, they have taken as 2 years, and the answer to this one is 0.73. So 0.73 has to be multiplied to 12. Mm-hmm. Got it? And when you are going to multiply it to 12, whatever you are getting, you have to round it and you are going to add it to 2. Let me just tell you what I am telling you. 2305 divided by 3175. What do you get? 0.72. You are going to get 0.72. 2 years. And multiply it with 12.
9 months.
Got it? So like this you have to, I hope you are clear. So 2.73 basically means the same. 2 years, 9 months, 73% of 12 months is 9. Got it? 0.73 means 73% of 12 months. Okay, now, so it was a quick discussion regarding the adjusted payback. Okay, now risk-adjusted discount rates. My dear students, what is the risk adjustment in the discount rates? Whenever the cost of capital is being used in order to discount your cash flows, it means that the discount rate which you are using, it is actually according to the risk portfolio of your own company. Ready-made discount rates can be used in order to calculate the present value of your cash flows, but the condition is that the risk portfolio of your company should be the same one to those ones who have given you that particular discount rate. If the risk portfolio of your company is not the same, it's not according to the discount rate which you are using, it means that it is not adjusting the risk accurately. So the discount rate which you are using should be accurately determining the risk of your own company. That risk can be the gearing risk or the capital risk, whatever it is. So it should be as per the portfolio of your own company's risk. If it is not, then it has to be adjusted as per the risk premium of your own company. My dear students, in the market, risk rates are available. Say, for example, the government bonds can be purchased, and on that government bond, the risk discount rate is being given, interest rate is already available, but that one is risk-free rate. When we do purchase a government bond, we are taking 0% risk. No risk is involved over there. So that one is risk-free rate. We can use that, but we have to add certain kind of risk, certain kind of discount rate, which is as per your company's portfolio. When one person is going to invest in your company, obviously he or she will be taking higher risk. Higher risk, higher return. So risk-free rate cannot be used over there. So that particular discount rate has to be adjusted. Getting my point? So that is why they are telling that our discount rates should also be adjusted. What your book says, now let's read. The discount rate we have assumed so far is the rate that reflects either the cost of borrowing funds in the form of loan note, that is the government ready-made one, or the underlying required return of the business, that is the return required by the shareholder, or a mix of both. So if it is just the first one, the cost of borrowing funds in the form of loan note, it is the risk-free rate plus the underlying required rate of return of the business, that is risk premium, or the mix of both. If an individual investment or project is perceived to be more risky than the existing investments, the increased risk could be used as a reason to adjust the discount rate. So this is the key concept in investment appraisal. Applying the existing discount rate or cost of capital to an investment assumes that the existing business and gearing risk of the company will remain unchanged. If you are using the ready-made discount rate from the market, it means that your company's risk and the used one, discount rate is the same one. There is no change in them. If the project is significant in size and likely to result in additional risk, then the project specific or risk adjusted discount rates should be used. The application of an increased discount rate is often successful in eliminating marginal projects. The addition to the use of discount rate is called the risk premium. This method is used, the method used is examined further in the cost of capital chapter. So this concept we are going to discuss in detail in our cost of capital chapter also. Now, my dear students, the requirement of the question is what is the discounted payback period and the net present value? So a scenario is given. Now, over here, you have to use the discounted payback and you have to calculate the net present value also. Can you do this?
Yeah.
Discounted payback, first you have to discount the cash flows, then you are going to calculate the cumulative cash flows, you are going to calculate the discounted payback period, and you have to calculate the NPV as well. Can you do it quickly?
Yeah.
Okay, two investments are there now. Can you see? One investment is at year zero, and the second one is in year one. The cash inflow from the project will be 16,800 at the end of year two and 14,400 at the end of the year three. At 15% discount, all these cash
flows. Right?
Sorry, why NVT factor? Is this NVT? What is NVT? Same amount of cash flow up to the known number of period, but this is not a continuity. Continuity is not there. The present value.
15%.
Is how much cash flows present values have you got?
6,000.
This one is
4176.
Okay.
12,700.
12,700.
Or 701.
701?
Second year. 701. 12,700.
Okay. 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 Okay then.
9475.
9475. Okay. So the NPV is 6,000. So either this one is the answer or this one is the answer. Options are given. Okay. Now you have to calculate discounted payback. 0, 1, 2, 3. The present value of the cash flows 12,4176, 12,701. 9,475. Calculate cumulative cash flows. The first one will remain 12,000. The second one. Second one.
Yeah.
Both are negative. How much?
16,173.
Okay, then this one. 3475. This one. Okay, now in between year two, in between year one and year two, it has converted into positive. So 2 years plus 16176 divided by 12701.
Yeah, so 1.27 is
1.27. Let me see if it's the right one. Understanding number 6, 12,475. This one is negative. This one is negative. You did not tell that this is negative. So in between, this is wrong then.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Why is this?
In between year 2 and year 3.
Again, there will be
3475 divided by 9475.
6,000 is last. Instead of 12,950, it is 6,000.
No deal.
In the year 136 now. In the year 136. In the year 3, instead of?
No, it's instead of this one.
Yeah. 6,000.
It's 6,000.
Yeah.
Okay, now.
3475,
for how much?
0.36.
Yes, now you are right. 0.36. So in both the ways you can take it, either 2.36 years or multiply 0.36 multiplied by 12 as we did earlier. How much it is?
4.4.
Or you can take it 5. You will be rounding it. 4.32. So it's 4. So yes, you can take that one. Option D is the right one.
I'm gonna take a break.
Sure, you can. 10 minutes break, enough?
Yeah, no, then
sorry?
I think there's a time that
I'm not understanding.
We have a time that we can do play after the class.
Yes, you can. Okay, 10 minutes break.
I think
okay, students, the remaining questions from this chapter, from understanding number 7, only understanding number 7 is practical one, remaining are theory. Okay? So you can do it as your homework.
Chapter finish?
Yes. And now after the break, we are going to start with working capital management. As they come, we are on break, okay? After 10 minutes, 10 to 12 minutes, we are going to resume.
Yes, miss.
Yes, Angelica, we are back. Are you there?
Yes, miss, I'm here.
Okay, great. Now, my dear students, we are starting the second part of our book, second part of our syllabus, that is working capital management. We do have 4 chapters for this working capital management. One by one, we are going to look at the different factors of the management regarding working capital. You should be knowing that what is a working capital. We normally say that the excess of current assets to the current liabilities is known as working capital. And we do say that the capital which is required for the day-to-day activities in a business is known as working capital. Why do we say that working capital is the excess of current assets to current liabilities? It is because in financial management, it is a rule of thumb that the current assets have to be resourced using the current liabilities, and non-current assets have to be financed using the non-current liabilities. We cannot take a long-term loan in order to use it in our day-to-day activities. We have to see that how much excess of current assets to current liabilities is present, and that one should be used in our day-to-day activities. That is why working capital is known as an excess of current assets to the current liabilities. In this chapter, we are going to have a look at the elements of the working capital. Normally, we do know that all the elements under current assets and current liabilities do form the elements of the working capital. One by one, we are going to have a look at the elements of the working capital. We are going to see that what are the objectives of the management in regards to the working capital, which particular agenda they do want to meet while managing the working capital. We are going to have a look at the cash operating cycle. What are the elements of the cash operating cycle? Normally, the current assets and current liabilities. We are going to see about the calculation of cash operating cycle. We are going to see that in which different phases it is going to be used, and we are going to see about the length of the cash operating cycle. We are going to have a look at the different working capital ratios, operating cycle and liquidity ratios are going to be considered. And we are going to see about working capital investment levels also. Now, let's start our discussion regarding the elements of the working capital. As I told you that the excess of current assets to the current liability is known as a working capital. It means that all the items under the current assets, that is inventory, receivables, bills receivable, cash, are going to be included in the working capital, and all the items of the current liabilities like any kind of short-term loans, specifically trade payables, are going to be considered as the elements of the working capital. What your book says, let's read. Working capital is the capital available for conducting the day-to-day operations of an organization, normally the excess of current assets over current liabilities. They also say working capital management is the management of all the aspects of both current assets and current liabilities to minimize the risk of insolvency while maximizing the return on assets. My dear students, these are the two important points: minimizing the risk of insolvency and maximizing the return on assets. My dear students, you should be keeping in mind that the basic objective of the management regarding working capital is to have a balance among these two agendas. That is minimizing the risk of insolvency and maximizing the return on assets. Because assets do pressurize the management to increase their wealth, while the management is facing the pressure for maintaining liquidity in the organization. Either the liquidity can be increased or the profitability in the organization can be increased. There must not be a trade-off in between those. At the cost of increasing profitability, we should not be minimizing liquidity. Why is it so? We are going to look later also. Okay, now, here you can see the difference of the difference is equal to the working capital. The difference between the current assets and the current liabilities is working capital. Current assets include inventory, receivables, cash and bank, and in the current assets we require funding, consider reducing levels. On the other hand, we do have current liabilities including any kind of payables, trade payables or otherwise bank and overdraft. Provide funding, consider increasing levels. Let's look at this concept in detail. They say working capital elements, investing in the working capital has a cost, which can be expressed either as the cost of funding it or the opportunity cost of lost investment opportunities because cash is tied up and unavailable for other uses. You need to think deep about these two factors, my dear students. Whenever we are investing in the working capital, it is having its particular cost. When we do purchase an inventory, it means that we are giving an opportunity to the business to expand its profitability, to increase its profitability. But on the other hand, we need to consider that the cash which is now stuck up in the inventory is not going to be returned back unless that inventory is going to be sold. So it is the opportunity cost, the cash which has been invested in the inventory or the cash which is tied up with the receivables can be used elsewhere in order to earn profits. So this is the fact which you need to consider. So Working Capital Balancing Act, it is the basic objective of the management that they have to bring the balance in between liquidity and profitability. What is liquidity? Having enough quick assets in order to meet the solvency problems of the business, in order to meet the current liabilities of the business. Say, for example, if the payables are requiring the amount to be returned back, or for the short-term loans, we have to return the loan principal amount, we should be having enough resources. So balance of cash and the quick assets is known as liquidity. On the other hand, we do have profitability as a major factor also. What is profitability? Increasing the net profit figure in the organization is known as a profitability. And profitability and liquidity are not the same things. Liquidity is for the survival of the business, whereas profitability or the profit figure is the one which is calculated by following the accrual basis of accounting, which does not follow the cash basis of accounting. That whenever the cash is received, we are not going to record it. We are going to see that whether we have a, you know, right on that particular cash or not. When the rights and liabilities do arise, they have to be recorded in our financial statements. We are not going to record them as per the cash inflow and cash outflow. So the profitability is not the same fact as the liquidity. In order to survive, business should be liquid one. Even if the business is profitable, the business may not survive because it is not having enough cash resources. Because the current liabilities or the other liabilities have to be fulfilled using cash. They cannot be fulfilled using profit figure. We cannot tell our payables that our profitability figure is this much, take that profit and we are going to pay your liabilities. It's not the case. Everyone needs cash. So Balancing Act tells us that we should not compromise on liquidity on the basis of profitability, and we cannot compromise on the basis of profitability because of liquidity. Because once the profitability is increased, the liquidity is going to be affected. Why? Suppose a general example. If say, for example, we want to increase our sales, we are going to give our receivables the benefit of credit. We are going to tell them that please purchase our products, but you can pay us in the future. It means that now the profitability is going to be increased because we are giving the opportunity to our receivables for credit. But on the basis of this, our liquidity is going to be compromised. Or on the other hand, if we are going to have the strict credit controls, we are going to say our receivables that we are not giving credits. Whatever purchase transaction you have to make, it should be on the cash basis. It means that now our profitability is going to be compromised. The receivables will be stepping back. They will be telling us that we are not going to purchase since your credit limit is very tight. So both of these can be compromised on the basis of each other, and the objective of the management regarding working capital is that we have to make a balance among both of these. So they say liquidity, ensuring current assets are sufficiently liquid to minimize the risk of insolvency. What is the risk of insolvency? That the debts on the business are going to increase and we would not be able to pay them off. And investing in less liquid assets in order to maximize return, instead of pressurizing the persons to pay the liquid assets to the organization, just giving the liberty to make the organization more profitable. So this is the basic theme of working capital. In this chapter, my dear students, and in this whole portion, you will be getting some ratios, you will be getting some calculations, but the more requirement from you is to analyze. You will not only be required to calculate something, you will be required to analyze the situation as well. So they say over here that working capital management is the key factor in an organization's long-term success. The trade-off between liquidity and profitability and its role in determining a business overall investment in working capital is fundamental to your understanding of working capital management for the examination. That how much you should be investing in current assets to make the business liquid enough, as well as the profitability should not be compromised. Over here, they have mentioned the difference between the cash flow and the profit, as I have mentioned earlier also. Let's see in the language of your book. They say unprofitable companies can survive if they have liquidity. Even if the businesses are not making enough profits, they would be able to survive in the long run if they do have liquid assets present with them. Because in order to fulfill liabilities, in order to make investments, we do need cash. But profitable companies can fail if they run out of cash to pay their liabilities. On the other hand, even if the businesses are profitable, they may not be able to survive if their liquid assets are not present. So the profitable business having no liquid assets cannot survive. On the other hand, liquid business having no profitability can survive. Like they are giving us an example of purchase of non-current assets for cash. When we do purchase a non-current asset for cash, it means that the amount of cash is now stuck in that proper, in that particular fixed asset, in that particular non-current asset. Now that investment is going to be realized after some time, the benefit which we are going to avail out of that non-current asset will take some time. Up to that time period, our cash is now stuck. So our liquidity is now getting compromised. So they say the cash will be paid in full to be supplied when the asset is delivered. However, the cost will be charged to the profits gradually over the life of the asset in the form of depreciation. So what is the concept behind depreciation basically? The depreciation is regarding which accounting concept?
Financial accounting. Accrual. Financial, right?
No, not accrual.
Financial accounting.
This is as per finance, but in financial accounting, which concept tends to tell us that depreciation has to be taken?
Prudence.
Which concept are you talking about?
Which accounting concept?
Prudence.
No. Prudence concept tells us that all the foreseeable losses have to be recorded, not the foreseeable profits. The concept which tells us that the sales of the particular period has to be compared with the cost of that particular period. That is leading us to the concept of depreciation. Comparability principle. It tells us, my dear students, why we do take depreciation. It's not because the asset is losing its value. Normally, the students say that depreciation is taken because the asset is losing its value over the passage of time. That is why we do take depreciation. This is how the depreciation is defined by a layman, not by an accountant. Accountant says that depreciation is being recorded because the depreciation amount is the benefit which we have taken out of the total life of an asset. This is the expired benefit out of the total life of an asset. This is the concept behind depreciation. Got it? So depreciation tells us that this much amount of the benefit from the total value of the asset is now taken. So this is what they are telling, that depreciation is going to be recorded only after a year, but the total amount which we have spent in order to purchase the non-current asset is going to be recorded at once. Then sale of goods on credit. Profits will be credited in full once the sale has been confirmed. So the full sales, either cash or credit, is going to be recorded in our SOPL. On the other hand, the cash will be released only when the amount is going to be given us back by the receivable. So however, the cash may not be received for some considerable period afterwards. So hence, there can be a difference between the cash flow and the profit. Now, this particular difference brings on the concept of the profitability versus liquidity, because cash flow is not the same as the profit. That is why liquidity is not the same as the profitability. Profitability is increasing the net profit figure, which does not every time mean that the cash assets are also present behind it. So the organization may not be liquid even if it is showing a lot of profitability. That is why in the past days, so many organizations did collapse. They were looking profitable to the stakeholders, but they seemed to be very much astonished when they saw the companies collapsing. The basic reason behind, and the Cadbury report which they told us, that because the companies looked very profitable to the other stakeholders, but because they were not liquid enough to meet the short-term liabilities, that is why they did collapse. So what your book says, let us read it quickly. Liquidity in the context of working capital management means having enough cash or ready access to cash to meet all payments obligations when these fall due. The main sources of liquidity are usually cash in the bank, short-term investments, cash inflows from normal trading operations, an overdraft facility, or other ready source of extra borrowing. So all these are basically quick assets. The basis of the trade-off is where a company is able to improve its profitability, but at the expense of tying up cash. For example, receiving a bulk purchase discount, which is going to improve profitability. When the bulk purchase discount is going to be taken, it will be giving us the increased profitability. For buying more inventory than it is currently required, it is going to reduce liquidity. Offering credit to customers attracts more customers, so improves profitability but reduces liquidity, as I've given example. When we do give the credit to the customers, profitability will be increased, but the cash will be tied up with those receivables. So sometimes opposite situation can be seen, where a company can improve the liquidity position, but at the expense of profitability. For example, offering an early settlement discount to the customer. So in that case, the liquidity of the business is not going to be compromised, but profitability. Now, my dear students, in the organizations, we do see different kinds of approaches in managing working capital. Sometimes the approach can be aggressive, and sometimes it can be conservative. When there is an aggressive approach, it means that more amount is going to be invested in the current assets. It means that more amount is going to be tied up in the current assets. Whereas in aggressive, in this conservative approach, the organizations are going to be very much risk averse. They will not be tying up all the cash in their current assets. They will be thinking 1,000 times before investing in the working capital. There can be an overcapitalization situation as well. Again, this overcapitalization situation is related to the aggressive approach, where more amount is going to be invested in the current assets. So in that case, when a more amount is going to be invested in the current assets, it means that when the current liabilities are going to fall, the organization would not be having enough assets to pay them. Overtrading is related to the profitability. It means that, my dear students, in the case of overcapitalization, liquidity position will be good one. In the case of aggressive approach also, the liquidity position is going to be the good one, because in current assets, more investment is being put in. But in the case of overtrading, the profitability of the business is going to be good one, but liquidity is going to be deteriorated. It means that the organization is trading more. Organization is trying to make itself more profitable, but on the cost of liquidity. Clear, everyone? Is everyone clear? Angelica, are you clear?
Yes, miss.
Now they say in the exam, you might be expected to diagnose overtrading from information given about a company. You should look out for the following. So in the scenarios, they sometimes can ask you that whether a particular organization under consideration is overtrading or what kind of organization it is. So if there is a rapid increase in revenue, what do you think an organization is overtrading?
Yeah.
Yes, if there is a rapid increase in the revenue, organization is thinking about profitability. An increase in the values of the working capital days, particularly receivables and payables. We are going to look for receivables and payable days, but quickly telling you, receivable days tells us that in how many days particularly we are able to receive the payment back from the receivables. And payable days, in how many days particularly we are able to give the amount back to the payables. So if there is an increase in the values of the working capital days, what does that mean? Overtrading. Again, organization is overtrading. If the receivable days are increasing, the payable days are increasing, organization is overtrading. Most of the increase in assets being financed by credit. Overtrading. A dramatic drop in the liquidity ratios. Overtrading. Liquidity position is going to be lost if there is more investment in the working capital. So first we are going to start with the liquidity ratios, and the most popular ones are current ratio and quick ratio. There is a slight difference among current ratio and quick ratio. We are going to look one by one. Okay, now current ratio, as all of us are aware, current ratio is equal to current assets divided by current liabilities. We do not multiply it with 100. It tells us the ratio of the current assets to current liabilities. If the answer is 1 to this ratio, it means that current assets are equal to the current liabilities. If it is increasing more than 1, it means that current assets are more than the current liabilities. If it is lesser to 1, it means that now the organization is at risk. The current liabilities are more than the current assets. Whenever the debts are going to be falling due, organization would not be able to pay them off. So my dear students, we do normally say that the ratio of 2 to 1 is a good one. But again, organizations need to consider that every time the current ratio more than 1 is not a good thing. It also tells us that our cash is now stuck in the current assets and we are not able to use them anywhere else. So every time the good current ratio is not actually a good one. So we cannot merely look at the current ratio to see all the effects of the business. We have to see all the wider view in the organization in order to comment on something. They say, measure assets are financed by current liabilities. That is, current ratio is equal to current assets over current liabilities. A measure of 2:1 means that current liabilities can be paid twice over out of the existing current assets. So in short, 2:1 means that current assets are double than the current liabilities. Even if we twice the current liabilities would be there, the organization would be able to pay them. Then more stringent view of the liquidity ratio is quick ratio. Quick ratio is also known as asset test ratio. So what we do in the businesses which are normally having slow moving inventories, we do use the quick ratio. What we do simply current assets minus inventory divided by current liabilities, because if the organizations do have slow moving inventory and we are using current ratio, our current ratio would be seemingly very good one. But actually it is only because the organization is not able to sale off its inventory. That is why the quick ratio, that the current ratio is looking a very good one. That is why we do depend upon the quick ratio, asset test ratio. We just deduct the amount of current liability from the inventory amount from our current assets in order to get the quick ratio. So they say the quick or asset test ratio measures how well current liabilities are covered by liquid assets. So liquid assets are current assets minus inventory. Liquid assets are those which, or quick assets are those which can be easily converted to the cash, which are already in the form of cash or can be easily converted to the cash. So measures how well current liabilities are covered by liquid assets. It is particularly useful when inventory holding periods are long and therefore distort the current ratio. So quick ratio or asset test ratio is equal to current assets minus inventory divided by current liabilities. So a measure of 1:1 means that the company is able to meet existing liabilities if they all fall due at once. It means that current assets, liquid assets are equal to the current liabilities. Now, my dear students, we are going to have a look at the important concept, that is cash operating cycle. Cash operating cycle is merely a time in between purchasing an inventory and getting the amount back from the receivables. All the time in between these two points is known as a cash operating cycle. First, we do invest the amount by purchasing the raw material for manufacturing businesses. Then the raw material has to be converted to the work in progress. Then work in progress has to be converted to the finished goods. Then from finished goods, the sale of the goods is going to be arising. When sales are going to happen, the payables are going to take place. From payables, we then have to receive an amount. So the time period in between investing an amount into the raw material and then getting it back from the payables is known as a cash operating cycle. The lesser the cash operating cycle will be, the more beneficial it will be for the organizations. So they say the cash operating cycle is the length of the time between the company's outlay on the raw materials, wages, and other expenditures, and the inflow of cash from the sale of goods. The faster a firm can push items around the cycle, the lower its investment in the working capital will be. So the lesser the cash operating cycle will be, it means that quickly the organization is able to push the cash around the cycle and quickly it is getting its cash back out of it, so it can invest it again. So my dear students, here they have given us an illustration to tell us more about this cash operating cycle. So look, first the businessman is purchasing the raw material, converting it into WIP, then finished goods, then receivables, and then the cash is going to be received and then it is going to be paid to the payables back. So we do assume that by, you know, when we are purchasing the raw material also, it is also on credit. So if our receivable days are decreased, then our payables paid days are also going to be increased. So because after receiving the amount back from the receivables, we are giving back it to the payables. So the timeline they have mentioned over here, and then purchase, sales, received from receivables and sales are going to be used in order to calculate inventory and receivable days. With the help of purchases and inventory days, receivable days, we would be able to calculate payable days, and cash operating cycle will be calculated with the help of these two. Anyhow, do not confuse yourself about the ratios right now. We are going to have a look at them in detail. So how can we calculate the cash operating cycle? My dear students, as we have seen this illustration, the cash operating cycle is revolving around this ball. So calculation of the cash operating cycle is simply raw material holding period plus work in progress holding period plus finished goods holding period plus receivables collection period and minus payables payment period. This is a cash operating cycle. This will be telling us the time lag in between two points, that is purchasing the raw material and sending the payment back to the payables. This is the case for the manufacturing business. If the wholesaler business is there, then it's very simple. Inventory holding period plus receivables collection period minus payables payment period is the cash operating cycle in the case of wholesale businesses. They say in the last, the cycle may be measured in days, weeks, or months, as and it is advisable when answering an exam question to use the measure used in the question. So understanding number one is here, calculate the length of the operating cycle. A company has provided the following information: receivables collection period, raw material inventory holding period, production period, suppliers payment period, finished goods holding period is there. We can quickly calculate the length of the operating cycle. This amount plus this amount minus this amount plus this amount will be giving us the operating cycle. Is it? Sorry? 21 days. So it means that our cash, our working capital is stuck in this operating cycle for 21 days. We are able to get our cash back in 21 days. Clear, everyone? Okay, now working capital ratios and operating cycle. The periods used to determine the cash operating cycle are calculated by using the series of working capital ratios. My dear students, in this last understanding, they have already calculated the receivables collection period, raw material, inventory holding period, etc. But in practical questions, you have to calculate all of these by yourselves. So that is what they are telling us. The periods used to determine the cash operating cycle are calculated by using a series of working capital ratios. We need to learn a series of working capital ratios in order to calculate all those periods. The ratios for the individual components, inventory, receivables, and payables are normally expressed as the number of days, weeks, months of the relevant statement of the profit or loss figure they represent. The figures which we are going to use in the ratios will be taken from the statement of profit or loss. Now, students, here is an illustration. In this illustration, we are required to calculate the relevant working capital ratios. Round your answers to the nearest day. So different kinds of ratios have to be calculated. I think that I have fixed this one at the wrong place. Okay, first we are going to see this theory part and then we are going to do this illustration. Okay, so my dear students, the first ratio which we need to keep in mind is inventory holding period. It is the length of the time inventory is held between purchases and sale. It is simply the time for which the inventory is converted to the work in progress or the inventory is converted to the sales. So the formula for it is inventory divided by cost of sales multiplied by 365. If in the examination question they tell you to calculate it in the months, then you are going to multiply it with 12. If it is week, then you are going to multiply it with?
Months can be divided by.
No, not divided by, it's slash. It's slash. If they are telling you to calculate the days in months, then instead of 365, you are going to multiply it with 12. So the formula is inventory divided by cost of sales multiplied by 365. So it tells us the length of time inventory is held between purchase and sale. The formula is inventory divided by cost of sales multiplied by 365. Then raw material inventory holding period. It is the length of time raw materials are held between purchase and being used in production. From the purchase time period and the time that they are being used in the production, how much time is present in between? After purchasing an inventory, in how much time it is going to the production department is the raw material inventory holding period. So the formula is raw material inventory divided by material usage. My dear students, over here the simple inventory is going to be taken, but over here, if it's a manufacturing business, then you are going to take a raw material inventory divided by material usage multiplied by 365. In examination questions, they are going to tell you the percentage at which the material is going to be used. That out of total inventory, this much amount of material is used. The formula is raw material inventory divided by material usage multiplied by 365. Where usage cannot be calculated, purchases give a good approximation. So instead of material usage, if material usage is not present, you can simply use the amount of purchases given. So what is the formula? Raw material inventory divided by material usage. Then students, work in progress holding period. Work in progress is the raw material converted to the not yet converted to the finished goods, but in process to be completed and converted to the finished goods. So work in progress holding period, the length of the time goods spent in the production. How much time the goods are present in the production department, how much time do they normally take to be converted to the finished goods? The formula is work in progress inventory held divided by production cost. Where production cost cannot be calculated, cost of goods sold gives the good approximation. So where you do not have a production cost given, you can simply use cost of sales. So this is work in progress holding period. And then finished goods inventory period, the length of time finished goods are held between completion or purchase and sale. How much time the finished goods do take in order to be converted to the sales is known as finished good inventory period. For how much long the organization actually is holding the finished goods in its inventory warehouse. So it is calculated as finished goods inventory held divided by cost of goods sold multiplied by 365. They say for all inventory period ratios, a low ratio is usually seen as a sign of good working capital management. It is very expensive to hold inventory, and thus maximum inventory holding usually points to good poor practice. So we normally target a lesser inventory holding periods, because the more the time organization is holding the inventory, it means that the holding costs are increasing. Nowadays, organizations do rely on just-in-time inventory. As soon as they do require an inventory, they will be getting on the inventory from the suppliers. So the organizations do want to neglect the holding periods because it is very costly. Now, my dear students, we are going to end the lecture over here today. We are going to start from here in our next lecture. So I just suggest you that whatever we have finished today, and especially investment appraisal, do make a practice from the exam kit. And in the next week, we do not have a class for F9 as you do. So if you want me to take the online class, we can have the test in the online class. And you do have full week in between. You have a full week in between. Please practice the investment appraisal in between. And there are so many exam kit questions which you should be practicing in between. So try practicing them all. Do make sure that you know everything in that. And key to exam success is that at least solve the exam kit questions 3 to 4 times. Okay. You should be knowing that what is happening in those questions, okay? Whatever you are going to suggest, we are going to do on Thursday. If you are not easy to give the test on Thursday, even on Wednesday, if you do not want to lose your holiday. So you can give the test on the Wednesday also. But I just have to open the test document in front of you, and you have to attempt that.
We'll confirm if they want data from there also, they will start argue also. So my Thursday, the same time to ask also maybe
Sure. Otherwise, you can just practice on actually when we do have to take, because at the end of the working capital also, again, I will be taking a test. So just to make sure that you are revising the exam kit also, okay? So whatever you are going to see feasible, you can just let me. So any questions, anyone from today's lecture? Sorry?
At present, I think 7 months.
How much is left behind? We do have 20 chapters, and we are on chapter 8. It will be taking around half an hour to be finishing this chapter. So in the next lecture, we are hopefully we are going to finish working capital.
20
hours. No, total are 20. The major portion was the one which we have covered and the cost of capital. So working capital, maybe it is going to be finished. As I told you that around 20th of November, we are going to finish our syllabus. Around 20th of November. Okay, students, and thank you so much. And Shnita, any questions?
No, miss.
Okay.
Miss, but the test will be on Thursday, like same time.
Sorry, please?
The test will be like from 9 to 12 next week.
We can just, because Mr. Atif and Hashid, they are telling that they are going to look forward to it. They are going to confirm it then in the WhatsApp group.
Okay, fine, miss. It's fine.
Okay. So in the group, we are going to discuss about that.
Okay, miss.
Okay, take care.
Bye, miss. Take care.
Goodbye.